Good evening and welcome to our annual chapel service to honor the life and legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you created us in love to live together in community. We thank you for Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who was filled with your vision for our lives and who worked to bring that vision into reality. Fill us with your love and guide us to honor his example and live by his words, working to build the beloved community where everyone is welcomed, all are valued, power is shared, compassion predominates, and all your children know wholeness and well-being. Amen.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Nolani Araya-Rojas, and it's my pleasure to welcome you all to honor and celebrate the legacy of remarkable leader, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. As we gather today as a community, we will hear from a very special guest speaker, Ms. Tanita Williams, and listen to a collection of readings from student leaders and musicians. I would also like to welcome our congregation as we introduce the St. George's Vocal Ensemble and Chamber Collective for our musical selections. Today is a day filled with inspiration and reflection as we reflect on the legacy of one of the most greatest civil rights leaders in history, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Throughout his adult years, Dr. King practiced nonviolence activism and was one of the most prominent figures in the civil rights movement from 1955 to 1968. Joined together, we are reminded of Dr. King's vision that love, justice, and equality should be the guiding principles of our society. We'll not only remember Dr. King's dream for our community, but also recognize that change begins with us. It is my pleasure to now introduce Nicole Ayan, who will present the meaning of the day. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Nicole Ayan, and I have the pleasure of explaining to you all the meaning of why we are gathered here today. This year marks the 39th year in which we celebrate Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday. As a primary figure of the civil rights movement of the 1950s and 1960s, Dr. King devoted himself to peaceful protest amongst some of the country's most tense times. He led the country in advocacy against racial segregation endorsed by Jim Crow laws and demanded justice for the inequalities of freedoms and rights that Black Americans were subjected to. On this day, we commemorate his willingness to be an active voice for the Black and poor communities, to bring forth peace in the face of hate, his ability to unite the country in a time of conflict, and the imprint he left on our society long past his years of life. But what does this mean to us as the St. George's community? This year, we also commemorate both the 60th anniversary of the March on Washington, as well as the start of integration at SG with former student Conrad Young, both major points in our history. We must be reminded that despite having come a long way as a community, we still have the duty to remain consistent in our willingness for improvement. As Dr. King said, darkness cannot drive out darkness, only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate, only love can do that. In light of his words, I encourage you all to take this day and tomorrow as a reminder to not shy away from or choose to accept the racial conflict we still face today, to help create a welcoming and loving environment for all those who we come across, regardless of race, and to use your voice to advocate for yourselves and for the oppressed. Be open, be comfortable, and be accepting. We thank Dr. King for all his valor in fighting for his dream of equality for all. And I hope that collectively as a community, we can make it our dream as well.
What's going on, y'all? What's up? So as mentioned, we are here to celebrate Martin Luther King. But more importantly, our theme for this year is MLK, or From MLK to Me. But instead of preaching you a story about how I've tried to apply Dr. King's lessons throughout my life, I'd rather give you a moment where the stigma of violence has imposed itself onto my own life. See, Black people have a long list of stereotypes. I believe many of us are aware of them. It requires too heavy of a heart for me to say it here. So I'll let you guys use your own prior knowledge to apply that to my story. But by practicing nonviolence, we can go against everything people think we are. In other words, nonviolence can sometimes be the practice of becoming what people already expect us to be. When I was younger, I went to this youth I went to this vocational leadership program that practiced a variety of trades to simulate the experience of living off the land and everything that comes with it. My cousin Marcus and I took on this camp. I was about the age 13. He was 15. He loves to say I'm older. He's older, but he's only like a year and a half. It's like, it's not really that big of a gap. Like, he don't know what he'd be talking about, you know? But like, anyways, I'm 13. He's 15, whatever. He's my older cousin. He's very light-skinned. He doesn't look like me. This disturbing idea started to float around the camp, though. People started to believe me and Marcus's personalities or souls or whatever they were thinking got switched around at birth, and that Marcus belonged to the definition of what they thought was a black man more than me. And this hurt me, because not only because they were saying I wasn't black enough for them, but because they said these negative stereotypes they applied to my cousin, who I love very dearly and who's already seen by everyone in the world because he's from Springfield, Massachusetts, and all this, that he's already a negative person. And to see my cousin get hurt like that, and without him even realizing it sometimes, like, that's the little things that you don't get. He was defined as violent, as just everything black men are negative about. Realistically, this is one of the most outrageous things I've ever heard. And to be honest, I was furious. And I still am furious. I was hurt that their definition of blackness was aggressive. However, I did not let their unjust perception of me or my cousin sway me into lashing out, yelling at them, being angry, as I felt, as my emotions were. Instead, I decided to go a peace route. I didn't interject myself directly with them. I didn't make them known. And looking back on it, I definitely could have taken some steps to get my message across to them. But instead, I took a path that I looking back on it, I'm grateful for. I'm grateful that I didn't let them bog me down to their definition of blackness by lashing out and making a scene. By practicing nonviolence, I avoided becoming that definition of blackness that I hate, and I hate to see, and that so many people are, that's applied to so many people unjustly sometimes without even getting to know them. And it's moments like these, and reflective moments, that I'm able to see that it's constantly been from MLK to me.
Hi, I'm Krista Badu, and when I was younger, I loved books. My love for reading started with my mom. She called it story time, and eventually my mom stopped reading books to me, but story time never ended. One Christmas, she surprised me with a book I wasn't expecting that was called The Words of MLK. But this book also had words from Coretta Scott King, along with words and stories of her husband's life. Seeing how Coretta pushed for a federal holiday to honor and spread Martin Luther King's message shows that you can kill the dreamer, but not the dream. But more importantly, it shows the immense impact of having someone in your life who fights for your dream like it's their own, because it's their own. This was special to me because even though my parents were born in Ghana, a country with a different racial climate than here in the U.S., their experiences as immigrants in this country and their understanding that my identity as a black girl in America would impact every aspect of my life in this country motivated them to expand my knowledge of civil rights. And through them, I learned that despite the hardships I'm bound to face, I can overcome anything and achieve any dream with patience in times of hardship and in times of growth, and faith in my ability to overcome. However, it's important not to allow your patience to become tolerance of the intolerable. Disrespect is intolerable. Injustice is intolerable. Tolerance is accepting less than what you deserve, and for me, MLK Day is a reminder that tolerating anything less than your dream is to let your dream die. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Leon Correa. I'm sixth former, and if we haven't officially met, I am the dorm head of Eccles. I'm also the head of two IBC groups, Young Men of Color and Insight. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. has always been an icon that fascinated me at a young age, the one that has directly impacted my life today. Two words come to mind when I think of Dr. King: ambition and opportunity. Starting with my life and my lineage, my family has played a big role in instilling the value of ambition and seizing opportunities. I'm a descendant of enslaved peoples on both sides of my family. My paternal grandfather moved from Georgia to Massachusetts towards the end of the Great Migration, and my maternal grandfather, with his family, immigrated from Cape Verde to Massachusetts as well, with aspiration of providing my mother and her brothers with better opportunities. Both of these men worked tooth and nail to provide for the next generation. By doing so, they instilled the values that my parents have gave to me. As a child, I was reminded of the sacrifice and the hardships that both sides of my family had to endure. Knowing their history, of both of them, created my ambition, my want for change, my want for improvement, and my inability to be content. Like Dr. King, I have a dream, and I'm sure you all do as well. A plan, more accurately, and the idea that I've kept with me is to seize every opportunity and achieve my goals. Dr. King had an ambition for change, and when he saw the opportunity, he went after it. Dr. King and his ambition gave me the opportunity to want, the ability to freely chase my dreams and come here and live on this beautiful campus with the rest of you. Dr. King represents these values and what he is to me. You all should feel the same. Take advantage of this opportunity to be here. Strive for change and continued improvement of the culture here at St. George's. Pursue your dream as Dr. King did, because without that dream, I wouldn't be standing here today and many of the other people of color on this campus. Thank you.
As I sat down to write this for you all, I felt compelled to reflect on the courage that defines Dr. King's legacy. Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. exemplifies bravery as he fought for justice, equality, and for peace. Fearlessly, Dr. King was determined to face all obstacles only equipped with the weapon of nonviolence, truth, and love. This was never an act of weakness, but a demonstration of courage. Responding to hate with love and advocating for a beloved community required a courage that transcends the understanding of strength and a commitment to justice for a positive change. Courage is not an absence of fear, but a triumph over it. His fearless determination inspired and will continue to inspire so many individuals. I hope you all take in the lesson of Dr. King's courage as you are courageous in your own lives, advocating for positive change in our community and confronting the inequalities in our society. Let your courage serve as a guiding light for a better tomorrow. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I am Bani Ritsam, and I'm here to share music's important role in the civil rights movement. Music was used to unite and encourage continued momentum of the movement. It was pivotal to inspiring, mobilizing, and giving voices to the oppressed. The collective voices of the people created and sustained mass mobilization campaigns. Group singing not only helped strengthen activists to endure harassment and brutality, but singing also helped perpetuate unity. Unity against racism, unity in the pursuit of justice, and unity in the hope and joy and celebration of a better future. If you allow me a moment of reflection, back home, I often commute with my three older brothers. We are all super close to one another. Our bond goes beyond shared blood. And so even cars with them is precious time spent together. We always listen to music going from place to place, and it can sometimes be the background of our conversations, but more often than not, we just listen to what's playing. Despite a lack of verbal communication, we have a sort of dialogue through the songs we choose to play, and as a result, our bond maintains and becomes strengthened through our shared emotions and experiences. The music we play also echoes the unity we experience in the present despite my older brothers growing up and starting their lives beyond college, sharing music is still one of the ways we manage to stay together. With each song, we are taken back to our shared memories, and memories that evoke feelings of solidarity and love. It was very much the same for people participating in the civil rights movements. Music was an avenue that brought people together over shared emotions of the past, and these collective emotions of courage and joy sustained them. I invite you to listen to this musical offering from the Vocal Ensemble and the Chernobyl Collective, to have an open mind and let the music move you the way it has moved those who came before us. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Julianne Patterson, and I would just like to thank the entire SG community for participating in this service. Something as simple as listening to these evening speakers shows us what a diverse and rich community SG can be. Our community is a tapestry of different backgrounds and cultures. So, by meeting together, we bring our own thoughts, actions, and strengths to impact the world around us. Today, I hope that you are all able to take something away from this service. Once again, I'd like to say a very heartfelt thank you to Ms. Williams, our vocal ensemble, and Chamber Collective for our musical selections. To close today's service, Jesse Guay will lead us in a closing prayer after the congregation sings a final hymn.
This is a prayer written by Dr. King. O God, we thank you for the fact that you have inspired men and women in all nations and in all cultures. We call you different names. Some call you Allah. Some call you Elohim. Some call you Jehovah. Some call you Brahma. Some call you the unmoved mover. But we know that these are all names for one and the same God. Grant that we will follow you and become so committed to your way and your kingdom that we will be able to establish in our lives and in this world a brother and sisterhood. This that we will be able to establish here in a kingdom of understanding where men and women will live together as brothers and sisters and respect the dignity and worth of every human being. In the name and spirit of Jesus, amen.
My friends, life is short, and we don't have much time to gladden the hearts of those who walk this way with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind, and may the blessing of God be with us this day and always. Amen.